Good morning, everyone. First of all, I'd like to thank Dr. Balaji and his team for giving me an opportunity. To be honest, I wasn't really aware about the IIREF project. My bad, I should have known about it in the past. And I was searching for something on the internet when I came across this conference, and the name of this conference was something that I kept looking if somebody organizes a conference on the future internet research, because this is something which is very crucial. As the previous team has already said, we need to relook into the protocols that have been already developed. And like sir mentioned, my primary area is congestion control. I still look into some of the aspects of TCP and fundamentals of IP, because those are the core things on which the entire internet is running. So Google comes up with new TCP in 2017, and its entire data centers are now using TCP called BBR. And Google has been very actively contributing into IETF as well. So I follow particularly in IETF research groups and working groups, which are primarily related to queue management and congestion control. So the way we used to do work at NITK is that I was telling sir, I'm very happy that he mentioned, you know, there's a lot of effort that goes into preparing IETF, and even more effort to actually implement something and show it to the team, so that they are convinced about what idea we are proposing, it is actually being giving the same kind of results. So at NITK, which is converting now slowly into a research institute from a teaching institute, one thing that I tend to do is with my undergraduate students and postgraduate students, as a part of the course assignments, I try and ask them to implement some of the internet drafts. And I'm happy to report that as on date, we have completed implementation of more than 10 to 12 internet drafts and RFCs as a part of the undergraduate course projects, and that is something that the students come and tell me is the best way that they understand how protocol design works, and more importantly, how complicated it is to come up with a new protocol. Not a small modification and it will work magically. As small as a packet deadline can have a very important behavior pattern which we fail to understand when we look into theoretically. So I closely work with the NS3 simulator. Since past 2 to 3 years, we have been contributing a lot of code into NS3, and I am glad to report that it has been merged into the main line of NS3. So since NS3.24 onwards, currently it is 3.29, which is the latest version. In all these 5 versions, there is a lot of code that our students have merged successfully. And if we see carefully, all of these implementations are either from an internet draft or from an existing RFC. In fact, some of the times we have also taken an RFC, taken an NS3 simulator or a Linux kernel code, and we see that RFC is not aligned with, the code is not aligned with the RFC. So we go back to the NS3 simulator developers and say, this has to be aligned with the RFC. The implementation was done when the internet draft was in progress. After it has got an RFC number, you can see there are a slight bit of differences, and this code needs to be aligned. I'm very glad to share, just last week, we got a Linux kernel patch accepted by David Miller into NetDev, and the new version 5.1 will have small piece of code, maybe just 60-70 lines contributed by our students, where we found out that RFC 8033 compliance code is not available, and then we just made the Linux kernel patch to align the existing code to match the RFC, whatever RFC mentions. While I was working on these NS3 projects, I was using NS3 Wikipedia to learn most of the aspects. I came on one particular project that attracted me, and I started looking into it. And since a couple of years, I have been slowly trying to do some work on this, because this is very new. It's called Named Data Networks. Now, I think many people will be aware of what is a Named Data Network. So I'll slowly go and talk about what are the opportunities for R&D. What is the work that we have done? But before that, I just want to confirm that I'm sure that many of you might have heard of named data networks already. Any chance we have those who have heard it for the first time? The named data networks. Anybody who has heard the named data networks for the first time? Okay, there are quite a few. Okay, fine. So then I'll try to take it in that way so that we can try and explain what is the motivation of this particular project. So this is a presentation overview. Basically, we'll start with NDN, we'll get familiarized with the terminologies. We will see how NDN implements forwarding and transport. Then what work we have done. Beacon and GCP, I'll tell about the full forms as well as discuss what kind of work we did there. Then how if, for example, after this talk, we form a small group and we decide to work on NDN together, what is the best way we can try putting our hands on into NDN area? So there is an NDN sim which is completely based on top of NS3, and as I told you a brief about my work on NS3, it is because of this tool we were able to use NDN sim very quickly, because it's a wrapper on top of NS3. So you don't need to learn any new thing if you are already aware how NS3 works. You can just pick up the NDN sim and start playing with the fundamental examples which I am going to show you in this presentation. And many a times we have some assumptions made inside the simulations, and which is why we always say it is better to have a real-time implementation. So is it possible to have a real-time implementation of NDN? Yes, there is something called NDN forwarding daemon, which you can install it in your operating system, and you can start doing small testbed creation using NFT. And for example, are there any NDN applications that people can use? There is a very fundamental application that NDN developers have provided. It's called ChronoChat. And it's basically a normal instant messaging application like we people use in our day-to-day life. Only thing is, instead of working on the traditional TCP/IP stack, this works on the NDN stack. And it's a full-fledged library. We can install it in our operating system, deploy the NDN application on top of it, and start doing some small messaging. And it permits group messaging as well. It permits individual messaging as well as it permits messages in groups. And I'll tell you what are the next goals with what we are looking forward and seeing that if we can do something really big in the area of NDN, since it's picking up and it's a brand new architecture for the internet to make it more scalable. So let me take you through the introduction of NDN. When I started reading it, I came across Van Jacobsen's paper, fundamental paper on NDN, and the way he explained was very beautiful. So what he says in the paper, he says, there was a telephone network which was working fine, there was a radio network, there was a television network which were all working fine, then what was the need for us to think about the internet? Why did people think about the internet? The basic problem is that, let's say I'm using a telephone and talking to somebody, even if there is a small bit of a second of a downtime on the path on which my packets or my signals are going by, I have to basically see that the connection went off. I need to redial that particular number to talk to that particular person. Now, we all know that internet started with a main goal for the defense purpose. And the whole idea was to hide the network failures from the application users. So as a network user, as a network designer, you don't want the network user to be aware that there was a network failure because of which your connection is going off. Which is why we have the concepts of independent routing in the internet, where even if one route fails, dynamically we try to find out another route without letting the application know that actually there was a route failure on the way. This was something that was not possible with the telephone network. So what Van Jacobsen comes and says is that this was a really good thought, internet has really picked up very well, but what we did not realize is that internet, like a telephone, is a one-on-one communication network. Like we use telephone numbers to connect a particular person, we use the concept of IP addresses to connect to a different machine. And basically, one IP address talks to another IP address. One machine communicates to another machine. So it was fundamentally a one-to-one network. Whereas today, the demand of the internet is that it is more about content distribution. I'm not just happy if internet provides me the ability to communicate with you. I also want the ability to distribute the content with you. And essentially, what I'm trying to say is, when I talk about the content distribution, I'm talking about one-to-many. And that's something which is very difficult to achieve with the internet architecture. So we have studied broadcast. Broadcast is relatively easier, but multicast is really a challenge. And that's something what Van Jacobsen highlights and says that the internet scale, it is right now the need of the hour that the internet has to scale, because the demand of the internet is increasing. We recently saw motivation for IoT. We'll need more IP addresses, we'll see more devices, we'll see the sensors attached in this room, all of them connecting to the internet. The question that Van Jacobsen says is that, is our internet ready to handle this scale at what we are thinking that it will operate? Because the number of devices that are connected to the internet just 2 to 3 years back were 3 times the human population on the earth. And if that many devices are connected to the internet, we need to really worry about whether there will be one more collapse of the internet, the one that happened in 1986. Which was known as very popularly a congestion collapse. So are we going to come towards a collapse, or are our protocols fine enough to handle the load? And he comes and says, basically, how do we use a radio network? The content is everywhere. I just tune into that particular channel and I can listen to the content. Television, I switch from one channel to another, the content is already there, but it's me who has to change to one particular channel to get that particular content. So he says, the idea of NTN is that the content will be everywhere. You ask what content you want, and you should be delivered from the nearest possible device. So the whole idea of NTN is to provide content distribution abilities to the internet, but the most important point is it has to be backward compatible with the internet. We cannot say that it's going to, you know, stop working with the traditional internet and everybody has now to shift to NTN. No, that's not going to actually happen. We have seen how much time IPv6 deployment has taken already. We saturated the last IPv4 address long back, but still, you know, we have not moved to a completely IPv6 environment. So there is no intention to dethrone the current internet and then say this is the best one. No, it's basically how you add these facilities to the current internet and try and make it more scalable, more suitable for content distribution. A simple example is we all subscribe to apps like Hindustan Times or Times of India. The morning we wake up, we switch on our mobile phone. It's basically a content distribution. We have all subscribed to that service and that's a publisher of that particular content. Everybody who is subscribed to that service will get that notification from Times of India or the any other newspaper that we have subscribed to. So it's more about content distribution. The right now what we do it in internet is not going to scale if these content distribution applications are going to increase. For example, our multimedia applications are on rise. People have predicted that a larger chunk of the internet traffic in future will only be video. In fact, it is already true now that the majority of the traffic on the internet is video. And what kind of videos? Videos that are already stored. I'm not talking about the live streaming. Assume there are lots of videos that are stored. And recently there was a cricket match between India and Australia. And we know that India was 99 for down for 4 wickets. We know the last partnership was 141 runs. You just want to watch the highlights. You log on to YouTube and you will start fetching out that content and just watch that highlight. There will be many people in the same room or in the same building or in the same geographical vicinity where they will be interested to get the same piece of content. So sending everybody's request all the way to the server and fetching that YouTube content is actually going to reduce the scalability. What we should do is try and avoid the server getting communicated again and again. And if possible, we can have a cache of these video chunks distributed across us. The idea that I am revealing is pretty much similar to what BitTorrent already does. You know, BitTorrent chunks are already everywhere. You just are downloading at the same time you are uploading. NTN is slightly different than BitTorrent. We'll talk about that. So, the IP architecture is communication oriented. It's very good for communication. It was not designed for content distribution, what we are trying to do right now. And that's why it is difficult to scale. Why is the problem with IP? Because it's location-centric. When I want some data, I first worry about the location of the data by using DNS. So I use a DNS which gives me an IP address and then I go and ask that particular IP address, give me this content. What actually I am interested in? The content. I really don't need to know where it is coming from. I don't really need to bother. Of course, from security perspective, wherever it is coming from, it has to come from a trusted authority. But so long as I get this particular content, I really don't bother where the YouTube server is actually sitting or where the video provider is actually sitting. So it is location centric and not suitable for one too many applications. Today's demand is we need an efficient architecture to do content distribution. So what is the potential solution? One of the potential solutions that people are discussing right now is that focus on the content rather than the location of the content. So what you want is more important than where it is coming from. And one of the initiative, even at the IRTF, there is a research group that's called ICNRG. It's basically talking about the information-centric networking, which is a larger umbrella. And under that initiative, there are lots of small projects that came up, and some of them went on to become really big. One of them is NDN. There's another one called CCN, which is now not being spoken about too much. It's content-centric network. This is NDN name data network, a specific architecture designed under the umbrella of ICNRG. So this is basically the work that's going on even at the internet standards community, and they are doing a lot of research on this. So even when I was looking, so I have subscribed to ICNRG, and that's the best thing to do to know what they are doing. While most of the times we fail to understand what exactly is the discussion because they are way more advanced, but you know, just subscribing itself to these groups gives us a lot of idea about what's going on. So in my opinion, even though I was just telling sir before the debrief that we have not done too much of work towards contributing to IDF in terms of writing drafts, probably because we did not know it. Now we know there is a team that has already done it. There are more people in the room. I have looked at the speakers and I am excited to talk to them and know how we can start contributing. But one thing that we have done is that I encourage my PhD students and other students to at least subscribe to this group, so that if not talk, at least listen to what the discussions are going on. And there's really nice bit of discussion going on right now in ICNRG, and there are some sessions scheduled for this last week of March, which is IDF 104th meeting going to happen. So the NDN project was actually funded by NSF in US with I think $13.5 million. It was head by University of California at Los Angeles, and Van Jacobson, while he was at Google, I think he's still at Google. And right now, the National Institute of Standards and Technology have also shown interest in this project, and now they are taking care of this project right now. So there seems to be a lot of interest going on in NDN, and my idea in this particular presentation was to let the audience know that there are lots of opportunities both in research as well as in development towards this particular area. And this is the project website. I will be sharing this particular slides with Dr. Balaji, and he may circulate all to the interested participants. So no need to make a note of this. It's there and it's a very beautifully maintained website. If time permits, at the end of this particular presentation, I would like to show this website and a walkthrough to this website, so that you know where you can get the interesting publications. They have segregated the papers year-wise. 2019, how many papers? 18, 17. So it's very beautiful to see how basically the area has evolved from 2006 onwards, which the first paper came. Now 13 years down the line, what are the kind of work that they are looking forward? So this is basically a picture taken from their very fundamental paper of 2009, where they are trying to highlight that the old TCP/IP stack has the major focus on the IP, and that's the location, basically location of the content. Where if you see on the right hand side, that's an hourglass structure for NDN like networks. Not just NDN, but it can be considered for any other kind of networks that are focused on IC and information centric networking. And you can see the major focus is on the content chunks. So basically what I'm worried about is getting the content, not really taking too much care about where it comes. But one important thing that we see here was not considered, has been considered, is security. So those all who have been working on security, this is a really nice topic. The reason being that security is being thought as an inbuilt feature rather than an add-on feature, which we saw in the traditional TCP/IP stack. And of course, we are going to be backward compatible with TCP/IP, so we are not going to remove the other chunks which are there. We are still going to have them. So if you want NDN to work with an IP address, it's fine. But then you should have a specific use case that needs NDN with IP address. Most of the use cases will be, you'll have NDN without IP addresses. So now what's basically, if we don't use IP address, what is it that we are going to use particularly? Names, the content name. And that calls a very big open area for DNS, basically, because the whole idea has been taken from the DNS, and in fact they have made their own DNS, which is called NDN DNS. So right now DNS was used for name resolution. Given a name, you get an IP address. Now names will be used even for routing, not the IP addresses. And that's why your names, typically which were flat, now will be hierarchical in nature. And instead of identifying an IP prefix, you will have a name prefix. For instance, if I am publishing a file at an IP gate, the path of that particular file, like a URL we have, the path will be NITK documents, or let's say NITK videos, something something video file, and then this particular video can have 5 chunks. So it's a large video, I divide it into 5 chunks, and then I say video name slash 1, means it's the first chunk of this particular video. Now what could be the name prefix in this? Anything that comes from NITK can be a name prefix. So NITK is one name prefix. Once you reach NITK, then you start looking for either videos, or you start looking for documents, or you start looking for the chunks, individual, whichever you want. And that's basically called NDN forwarding and routing, which I will not be discussing in very detail, but I will give you a small glimpse of how NDN router actually works. So coming forward, there are some terminologies which we will familiarize ourselves and then go ahead with the actual working of NDN. So there are two types of packets in NTM. One is called an interest packet. For analogy sake, I have written that it is equivalent to a request packet in our current internet. And data packet is equal to a reply packet. Now, this is just for a simple example. This is not a rule, because you know we have lots of different sockets that we are already using in the internet right now. For example, we use a request reply socket. Right? When I request for some content, we get a reply for that. There is something called PubSub. That's called the publisher subscriber socket, where subscribers subscribe to one particular socket and the publisher publishes the data on that socket, and whoever has subscribed, everybody gets that chunk. Then there is something called push-pull. So sensor networks, for instance, are a best example where you can use a push-pull. What you can do is you can send an instruction to the sensor saying that every 10 minutes, give me the level of the humidity that you measure. And once I have sent a pull request, sensors keep pushing the data to me. So the current internet can handle request response very beautifully, the traditional TCP/IP, but where it faces difficulty is the PubSub sockets. So even though there are new implementations available, I am sure you might have heard about 0MQ, that is very popularly picking up for this kind of PubSub implementations of the on the internet stack, the traditional stack. But NDM says no, we'll try to rethink about the design from scratch and see how we can go and make it scalable. So if now let's look at consumer and producer. This is as good as like a client and the server in our current terminology. So the one who is going to make a request is usually a client, and the one who gives a service is a server. So consumer will send an interest packet and the producer will send a data packet. So this is a direct analogy between the traditional internet and NDM. So consumer will ask for content and producer will provide that particular content, right? Now, one important thing that is there in NDN is it's not necessary that your request, that means your interest packet, is given all the way to the producer. It can happen that your NDN router, who is between you and the server, can actually give back the data, because it has a cache of that data and your data need not be sent out all the way to the server. So that's possible, but for right now simplicity, we can assume client requests by sending an interest packet and producer gives a data packet. Optimized version of NDN is your producer need not always give the data. You can get the data from NDN router. Now, these things have changed over a period of time, but getting exact fields is very difficult because implementation slightly differs from what's written in the paper. So this is the basic architecture of an interest packet, where the most important thing in the interest packet is the name of the content, and in which, so for example, we know that when there are multiple chunks of a file or a video, we have sequencing in TCP that ensures that we get all the chunks and they are put up in order. So same kind of functionality is there in NDN, where you can tell the order preference, in which order you want the data to be delivered to you. And the publisher filter means you can also specify, if there are n number of publishers, you can tell I want it from this publisher itself. And then what is the scope of this particular work? This is for security reasons, they have added a norms. And look at the right side. When interest packet goes to the producer, the producer, when it is giving back the data packet, it also carries the content name. Why it carries the content name? Because the NDN router, when it gets the data packet from the producer, will look at the content name, and if it is very high demand, then it will put it in cache. So content name is important for the data packet also, not just for the interest packet. And there will be a signature. This is an important part of it. So there will be a digital signature by which you can actually verify whether the content that you are receiving is from an authorized trusted party or not, and the information about that signature is also there. For example, your publisher ID, your key, and what is the time that this certificate is valid. If I am receiving a data from a producer whose certificate has expired, I might as well discard that data. And if I see that the data is still valid, the certificate is valid, then I may consume that data. And actual data, what you want, that's carried. So now again, as I said, if you look into the real NDN SIM and the NFT, some more and less fields are there which are not discussed here, but this is a general packet structure. Used, there can be some more fields added as and when you have particular services in demand. So, as I have mentioned here, NDN router is different from a traditional IP router. We'll go and talk about the NDN router architecture. Again, this image is taken from the same paper which I used earlier. There were two notations. A right tick mark means there was a lookup hit, and a cross mark means there was a lookup miss. We are talking about this in terms of the cache. So, let's not look at the downstream. Let's first of all look at how the upstream data works. And this is a router. So on the left there is a consumer, on the right there is a producer. And the consumer sends an interest packet, and there are three entities inside the router. One is called CS, it's called content store. A simple name for that is a cache. A cache that contains the data, it stores the data. Yes, so now the question is, will router be actually caching the real data? Yes, it will be caching the real data. What about the privacy? Yes, so this is an open R&D question. Since now the data will be hanging around in different NDN routers in the internet, what about the privacy of this particular data, and what is the potential risk that my data has? So since the topic of my presentation is opportunities for R&D, throughout my presentation I will keep telling what are the opportunities that people are right now focusing and where more attention is needed. So one of the thing is, if your caching is going to work in NDN, then you need to ensure that the data that resides there has to be kept safe. We have little bit, very minor work we have done. In the subsequent slides I will show you, it's not very hardcore cryptographic solution, and in fact we have not implemented, we have just given a mathematical proof, implementation is still going on, but we will talk about what kind of risks the CS has. Now, if the interest comes and the match is found in the content store, then the data is given back to the consumer from here itself. No need for forwarding this particular data to the producer. Suppose if you don't find it in the content store, that means it's a cache, then you have something called a pending interest table. Now if you break down, you can see pending interest table means I have received so many interests, but I haven't yet given back the data. The reason I did not give the data to them is because data was not available in my cache. So now what I'm checking is, there is one consumer who has asked for the YouTube video of India-Australia match. There are another 10 users who are also coming and asking for the same content because the name of the content is same. What I will try to do is, when the interest comes, I will find out, did somebody else before also check for the same content? How do I check that? The list will tell you. In the list you have an entry, who has asked for what name, what content name. And if you can find a match, yes, this content has been previously requested by one person, then I will not forward this interest packet to the next hop. Instead, I will put this interest into this table. Once the reply comes from the producer, I will find out how many people are waiting for this content and send the reply to all of them, fundamentally. So what happens is, you try and stop the interest packet at the router level as much as possible. If you find the data here, good. You don't find the data, but you find that somebody else has also requested for the same content, then also the interest packet will stop here. The last one is called forwarding information base. Simple terminology, it's a routing table in terms of normal internet. What we call as routing table, we say that for this destination, this is the next hub. Some similar kind of data structure and similar kind of formation is there in FIB. And what you do is, you see whether the interest, so if the interest has reached FIB means it was not there in your content store, nobody has ever asked for this content, this is the new content that is being asked, and now if you have the information about that particular packet, you will forward it. Otherwise, what does our traditional IP router do? If it does not have an entry for a particular destination, it drops the packet, says that no route found. Correct? We have an ICMP error message that comes and says no route found, so please change the route. So even that can happen. That is this particular last one. You didn't find it here, nobody has ever asked for it, forward it if you have an entry. If you don't have an entry, drop the packet, and you can as well send a negative acknowledgement to the consumer saying that I didn't find any entry for this particular content name, and then now the consumer will probably try to change the name of the publisher and try to change the name of the content and then ask again. So this is how it works in the forward direction, right? Now, how does it happen in the reverse direction? In the reverse direction, FIB doesn't play a role. FIB is mainly for forwarding the packets, interest packets. Once the data is coming, what do? Once the data comes, I look into the PIT, same PIT here, and find out how many people were actually waiting for this data. And as many people I find waiting for this data, I send this same data to all of them. If nobody was waiting for this particular data, then I drop the data. Chances are there, because you have right now just asked for some content, so you will be definitely waiting for that particular content. So you first of all find out how many people are waiting for that data, send the data to all of them, and most importantly, you put a cache. You put a copy of that data in the content store. Now the big question is, that people are still working on, and it's very big open research, how large should be the size of the content store? Question number one. And all the old page replacement algorithms that we have studied in our operating system course are applicable here. So you will find research papers on the internet where people have compared LRU with MRU and said which one gives you better performance for a content store. So basically when your cache is full and a new data is coming, you need to remove some part of the cache and put a new one. Which replacement algorithm we will use, there's a big question mark, and application wise people have given the answers, and definitely there will be no one algorithm that will suit, but the point is there's a nice bit of work that's happening in this area where people are still trying to look into what are the best kind of page replacement algorithms or data replacement algorithms that can be deployed in cache. And more importantly, there's a nice paper that I found, I'll share that also with the Dr. Balaji. Basically it says what are the different kinds of data structures that people have used to implement content store. So the big question is not just the replacement algorithms, but the entire content store will be storing your data. What data structure will you use so that you can retrieve it very fast? The one that NDN SIM uses is called skip list. It's used in NDN SIM. If you would like to use some another data structure, you can as well implement in NDN SIM because it is open source. So they have some reason why they put skip list. They show the advantages in terms of the time taken to retrieve the data from this cache and forward it. So this is another very important area in my opinion where a lot of work is going on, and I will also share the name of the simulator which has been dedicatedly prepared to do this replacement algorithm comparison, and actually you can do an analysis of data coming in and see this. So I'll share a paper in which we have given the source code openly available. You can directly take that particular tool, run it and see. We have compared 6 different page replacement algorithms in this based on a particular application. So is this fair enough? The working?
One question.
Please.
Regarding the fifth part.
Regarding the fifth part.
Okay. Is the search still based on the content name?
Yes. Yes. The prefix of the content is stored here. So I look at the prefix of that content and decide who will be the next hop.
So how is the population of this fifth?
Yes, so there are dedicated routing algorithms, like there is an OSPF modified version of NDN which is called OSPFN. There is OLSR protocol which we have studied for MANETs, like AODV is one, we have studied OLSR, there is NLSR. So there are dedicated forwarding algorithms which have been prepared which will come and populate your FI based on the name prefix instead of the network prefix, which was the traditional way we were routing. So they prepare the FIB, and in fact the most popular protocol that they have been using right now is NLSR, but a lot of work has been done on AODV also. There are new protocols that people are considering because you have to change all of its functionality which was based on the network IP and now make it on content name. So that's how basically your FIB works.
And how is the interaction with the IP layer now? Because it's still there, right?
If you want it, it's there. If you don't want it, this can work independent of the IP layer.
No,
so you don't.
Where I got confused is, like, when you were comparing the R-glass models, there was still IP in the bottom.
Which models?
Like the two R-glass thing that you had.
Yeah, okay.
So there was still IP there. You had put IP below the content thing there. So
correct.
I still assume that the actual packet when it's going on
right
the wire
now,
still has an IP.
Exactly.
So what is the relationship between who? Where is the mapping between the
content? So if you currently. What basically they did is, in the initial testbed that was prepared, because the entire network works on IP, they couldn't get rid of the IP in the single shot. So what they did is, they mapped the content name with the IP in the beginning. But right now their testbed is independent of the IP. And now eventually they have removed the dependency of the IP. But as I said, one thing that happens very commonly in the standardization is that whenever we propose some new thing, the first question that comes is it backward compatible? And for showing the backward compatibility, in the our class they keep IP here, because if they remove IP, then there will be a lot of flare from other people saying that we have been using IP since so long and you are telling remove IP from the our class. So IP is there for a reason, that it is compatible, but then at the end your scalability will be still little bit limited because of the fact that you are going and finding out one particular IP address. So yes, there is IP dependency if we want it. As on date I can say, if I was to talk about
basically where I'm getting confused is, in the fifth table, once I've got the name,
yes,
the name maps to an IP.
Yes, in the old structure.
So in the new structure, where does it map to?
The name. So basically, I have a prefix.
So it will map to only out interface.
Yes. So we have a longest prefix match. So once a name comes in, I have a prefix. I find the longest prefix match. and there is a corresponding column which says if this is the match that you get, then this is the outgoing interface. So for example, I can explain in a little bit.
I think it's clear.
Yeah. So for example, how do I store entries in bit? Let's say 10 people asked it. I don't know who they are because I don't know their IP address. What basically bit stores is the interface at the router from where the request came, and I just store the interface numbers. So when I get the data from the producer, I look at which interfaces asked me this data and I forward it simply on that interface instead of looking at who asked for it. I hope that. So same way, now FIB will be having an outgoing interface for a particular match, and as you rightly asked, who fills in that table? The routing protocols which are particularly designed for NDN will fill up this content prefix, will go to this outgoing interface. Now on that outgoing interface, it goes to the next hop, again the same kind of strategy.
I have two questions. The packet is not dropped in IP.
The packet is not?
Not dropped, it's sent to default order.
I did not get the question, I'm sorry about that.
If the IP doesn't match.
If the IP doesn't match, IP in the sense?
If the
content name doesn't match. Okay, if the content
IP doesn't match, so it's it's sent to default order instead of dropping the packet and then.
No, in this particular case, they are dropping the packet because what the router is trying to say is that I don't know where this content is, right? I don't know the producer of this content.
And if it doesn't have the content, so it should not drop, it will flood the other routers. Send it on the connection of the router to the next hop. It will not drop the packet.
The current internet you mean to say? Or you are asking a question about the NDN? So I'm getting confused whether you are.
I'm asking question how do you manage flooding in the.
Maybe
actually what he was asking is like if I'm requesting for a particular service, so I type like google.com. Press the IP address. If it is not available in the default DNS, you go for the global DNS where it can find.
Yeah.
So, finding the alternative is where I can get that IP.
Right.
So, likewise, if I'm searching for a content by using the tags,
yeah.
If it is not available,
yeah.
Whether it is dropping or not, if it is dropping, like how it is doing.
So, basically, when you use DNS and when you use google.com, if you are not able to resolve, you go to a high level DNS server.
Yeah.
Here, if we recall, all that work is done by the client side. Router doesn't go to the DNS and find out the IP address. It's done by the client side. So similarly, if your router says that I'm not able to find the content, there is a NAT that goes back, or if you drop the packet, there won't be a data that will be sent. There will be a similar TCP timeout mechanism at the consumer. I didn't get the data within a small amount of time, or I got a negative ACK from you. What I will do is I look at the NDNS. NDNS is an NDN DNS, where all the popular publishers' data is kept and what content they have produced is listed. So now what I will do is, as I said a while ago, if you look at the packet structure, I have an option to select the publisher. Correct? What I will do is, if I see my data is not found for a particular publisher, I can let the consumer know. What the consumer will do? Consumer will now find who is the other publisher for this particular content and then change the content name based on the name of the publisher plus the location. I mean, location as in the name entire with slashes, NITK/video. So let us say you search for a video, in NITK/videos/something, you didn't find the video, the router didn't find the video. Router says, I don't know who NITK is because the prefix is not matching in my FIB. Once you send a negative acknowledgement back to the consumer, now instead of NITK, it will say IISC/videos because it knows from the NDNS that another publisher of this particular video is IISC. So that problem is handled by the consumer. The router doesn't do anything. Router it sees. I have a FIB means you can treat it as a routing table. In the routing table, I don't find a route. I drop it. And the reason I have written all here is that it's still not very clear whether they will support NAC or not, because it was added, it was removed, it was added again. And the current status is removed again. So NAC is not a guarantee whether it will be there in NDN in future or not, but one thing is that if you don't find the root, you simply drop
it.
Once you drop it,
does it drop?
Sorry?
Does it forward the packets or does it drop?
If it finds an entry in the FIB, it will forward, otherwise it will drop.
I think the question I think is that for the bootstrapping,
even in IP routing you drop. I think his assumption is in IP routing we don't drop.
In IP also
there is a default drop.
There is an ICRP redirect message. So the current internet works
for you to have a default drop. That's yeah. just something that you
yeah,
have.
The equivalent of default route, I think, is what he's trying to say.
So default
route. You actually populate it in a way that you know, you bootstrap the thing, right?
The router.
Have anything at all.
Right. FI will have nothing at all.
So when
yes.
the request comes, when something is not there.
Yes.
So what he's asking is that whether the request will be forwarded on all the interface, all the interfaces, and the bootstrap thing. Right?
Oh, oh no, no.
That's
no,
the question.
No, 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 sir.
It should forward to all the router.
No, no, no. So, if I'm not wrong, I have probably understood what the question is. See, try to look at it. This is a data request. This is not a control packet. If it was a control packet, it will do what you said. For example, if I am an OLSR routing protocol, and like sir said, if I don't have an entry in it, I will do a broadcasting and probably try to find an entry for that and store it over there. That happens if you are doing a routing algorithm run. Like when you bootstrap, your routing algorithm triggers, it does broadcast. At that time, what it does, sir, is it broadcasts the routing packets, finds out this particular information, and starts creating an FIP. And this is a periodic process, like OLSR protocol.
And so if you broadcast, if you flood all the flooding is more
that is how our routing protocols always work. They always broadcast.
No,
OLSR has a restricted broadcast. We call it as a restricted flooding. But then routing protocol information is always obtained by using a restricted flooding or flooding. But for the data packet, there will be no broadcast. That's what I'm saying. If the consumer is requesting for a content, and if it is not found, it is not broadcasted to other people. It's not broadcasted. The one that is broadcasted, like sir said, is during bootstrapping, when like he was asking, how do you form the FIB in the first place? Those algorithms will broadcast the control packets so as to collect the information and form that two column table. If I don't find something in the table, I have to wait till my next update. In my next update, I will possibly get a new entry. Like for example, in the internet today, if new routes are established, frequent running of the routing protocol tells me that now a new route is available, which is better than the past one. So I update my routing table. But if not, then I have to wait until the new route is established. And the broadcasting
yes, so
essentially works there.
So in other words, suppose some server,
yes.
the new content has come.
Yes.
Not
correct.
So
now the publisher has published new content. So
yeah.
the publisher has X number of contents. Now when the publisher publishes new content, it informs the end DNS that such a kind of content is available. And first consumer, let us say, who identifies that now this new content is available, will ask for that content, will not find a route over there. The default route will be provided in the end DNS that if you don't find the route in any NDN router, then you have to go through this particular route and then try to get it. And one important thing, as soon as your new, let's say the question is pretty similar to, let's say Google has added 10 new servers, they have 10 new IP addresses that are public now. How will DNS find out that those 10 new IP addresses are added? Something similar is the content addition. So if you have added new content, you are supposed to tell how to get that particular content as a publisher, and you have to update your end DNS. Through end DNS, the consumer will find out the default route to get to the content, but next time onwards it will be cached at several places, and then from the cache itself I can retrieve. I'm not very sure whether I got your question till now.
I was just saying that in the router, there is a forward, there is a drop.
Yeah.
If there is not a match in the pending interest table.
Pending interest table, if it is not matching, I go to FI.
Forwarding order.
Forwarding information base. Yeah.
Forwarding information base. So after that, it broadcasts to all the routers.
It doesn't broadcast. It doesn't.
So what does it do?
It sends back a notification to the consumer saying that I am not able to fetch your data. It's NAT. Assuming NAT
no,
is.
I don't think so.
No, that's the way NDN is designed particularly. But nevertheless,
can
I will be happy to.
Example of forwarding algorithm.
Sorry?
Forwarding router algorithm.
The forwarding?
This FIB, can you give me the. How does it work?
Like I said, I mean, the formation. Okay, let's do one thing. Why? We can take off this discussion maybe after the presentation. I'll be available here today and tomorrow. I can point you directly exactly how FIB is created. I can give you a demo of that and show you which algorithms are essentially used in creating an FIB. Maybe that can resolve this confusion that it's forwarding. But one thing I can for sure say, and I assume, I request you to assume so, that is that the data packet will not be broadcasted. The data packet, the request will be, the interest packet will not be forwarded, and the consumer will have to find it. sir, please.
So one thing is, if all the requests are unique, so ultimately it is our current scenario.
Exactly.
So where consumer is directly connected.
Yes. Yes. Yes.
Second thing, so so we do not get advantage.
No, you don't get any advantage.
Second case is, if see, already there are millions of websites, and each website, even if we take like YouTube itself, there are billions of video. Now for each video, there are like multiple enhancements, 720p, 480p, so all those contents are different. Now searching through all those contents, even if it is in your DNS router, so it's a very cumbersome process. So isn't it hampering the performance rather than increasing the performance?
No. So ideally, you are not looking at the entire content at one NDN router, because one NDN router cannot store all the chunks of the video. You have only limited chunk. Like it's a normal trade-off that we have in the performance in our processors. If I have the data in the cache, I can perform the operation very fast. If not, I don't. So the idea here is, remember one thing, that NDN is particularly for content distribution. So your traditional services that you are using on IP are not going to be touching NDN at all. For example, sending an email through NDN is not the right thing to do. Correct? So what is the right thing? The world is right now living with the fact that most of the content is replicated, most of the content is shared, and the requests for the same content are coming. So if you give me a direct condition that there is everything unique happening in the world, then I will say there was no need for an NDN. The fact is not that. The fact is that we have a lot of duplicate videos. So you asking for a YouTube for the same video, I asking for the same video from the same building, happens several times. But what if our gateway can cache that video and give me that video directly because you just accessed that video? I reduce the traffic on the internet, I reduce the burden on the internet, I reduce the burden on the servers, I make it a little more scalable. But again, the trade-off is straightforward. You get it in the cache, you don't get it in the cache, hard luck.
Oh, sir, but in that way, our router has also have a lot of memory.
It has. This router is complicated, and in fact, lot of network device companies are actually looking forward to manufacture this kind of routers. Because the traditional routers will not be able to have your contents. So, and more importantly, those routers don't have the algorithms to form the FI. Right? And not to go too deep, but I can tell you that NDN is also being combined with SDN, where you separate the control plane and the data plane, and you have just the control plane smart enough to understand NDN, and your data plane is very dumb. You just tell the data plane where to forward what. This interface coming in, this interface going. So NDN is also easily compatible with SDN, but only thing is that the controller that you will have in the SDN, which wants to run NDN, will have to have new algorithms to create a FI. I hope I was able to partially answer.
Yeah, but I'm still doubtful about its advantage.
No, it's not just you, sir. It's the entire world that has a doubt on NDN.
DNS queries, sir. In DNS queries, there are a lot of DNS queries are coming in the routers and all, right, sir? DNS
routes
or servers. In that case, actually, this content, will that store the query, each and every query?
Oh, you mean to say the DNS query?
Yes, sir.
So, I think there are DNS caches. But the one right now that
yes,
we use,
yes.
We can have similar kind of DNS caches dedicatedly reserved, not in collaboration with content store. Content store will store only your data.
But
if you want to have separate caching, you can as well have. That's permitted. Yes.
The data only, sir. Suppose I'll say that www.google.com.
Yes.
For that, I need to know the IP address.
So your IP is coming back.
Yeah.
That is the data, so that will be stored in the content store. If you are having like his question was, will it work with IP? So if it works with IP, one of the question.
His question is, sir, performance will be actually not, you cannot measure the performance between the router scenario and this NDN network. It will be actually exactly same in that kind of.
No. So right now also, if I'm not wrong, our browsers do cache the DNS, right?
Yes.
If I send a request, my browser itself gives me back. Do you think not having a cache will be better than having a cache? Is that you are claiming?
No, not like that, sir.
So what basically I am saying is, see, there's a limited memory that you have. It's not an infinite memory. Only those requests are cached which have been passing through this particular router. So all the comparison that you do is only with the size of the content store. Now, size of the content store you will not have too large, otherwise imagine NDN router manufacturing cost and the purchase cost will go so high. So actually content store is not really big. And as I said, right size of the content store is a hot discussion right now. If you keep too much of content, exactly that will happen. You will waste a lot of time in searching through it. Similarly, the same question applies. How big should be your PID? Can you store like 1 gig entries in PID? Then going through the PID itself will be a big problem. So the size of the content store, the size of the pit, everything has to be optimized to give you the actual performance. And the doubt that sir has, you know, is not something that he is the first person to raise. Let me tell you, if you go to the community and read about NDN, there's a lot more negative perception also saying that this will not be possible to deploy in the real world. So there are both kind of teams that are coming forward, where one team is pushing and proving it with the proof of concept. The other team is saying, no, this is not logical, this is not correct, it will take. But then that is how the best comes out. You have to have both the people. At ITF also we have the same thing. Somebody says yes, somebody says no. So definitely what your point is, if it's not implemented well, I should say, then it will come back to square zero. Yes.
It is difficult to quantify its benefit over.
Until we don't test it, until we don't run experiments with it, it will be difficult to say. But then there are reports by these people from UCLA and they have done pretty good job of showing that it works. So that's why ICN is, as I said, NDN is just one part of ICN. Even in India, we had an initiative by TCS. They are not using NDN. They have made an overlay ICN, which is a different kind of a network, which is under ICN umbrella. They are not complying with NDN. They say ours will have a better feature. So, you know, there's a lot of work going on. Like I said, there was CCN, there is NDN. There are lots of many other things that people have proposed. But the one thing that's pushing hard into the community with proofs, simulators, Linux kernel code, real testbed implementation is the NDN. And at the end of the presentation, when you see, I will leave you with the information, you will believe that that information is not available for the other kind of networks that have come up under ICN. So it's like, why TCP/IP won against OSI? It's coming back to that question, because it got deployed way more sooner, and by the time OSI came, people were not interested to eventually go and change all the things with the TCP/IP. Same thing is more or less happening with NDN, because they are proving the demonstration by proof of concept. They have a simulator already going on, 2.7 version has come. There is a forwarding daemon which you can put it in your Linux. Anyway, I'll go fast because we have to cut short the presentation in another 20 minutes. So, the NDN forwarding and transport. Now, for example, some people researched, can we use TCP in NDN? The question is, TCP has a self-clocking behavior. I send you a packet, you give me an ACK, so I get an inference of what is an RTT, and then I try to be. So, entire TCP algorithm depends on RTT. Now, the problem here is, your RTT cannot be accurate, because I can get the reply from the nearest router, or I can get the reply directly from the producer. If it's coming from the producer, it will be a long RTT. If it's coming directly from the NDN router, it will be a very short RTT. So I cannot assume that the short RTT means there is no congestion in the network. There are many congestion control algorithms, including Google's new TCP BBR, which is looking into delay and utilization of the link as a metric to decide the most important property of TCP. Should I increase the sending rate? Should I reduce the sending rate? Increase the congestion window, reduce the congestion window. And the most popular one that we have studied is additive increase and multiplicative decrease. You increase additively, if there is congestion in the network, you reduce multiplicatively, typically by half. Now, there are other TCPs which became very popular, like Vegas, which are completely based on RTT. So they say, is RTT increasing? Potentially there is congestion in the network. Is RTT reducing? Network is becoming congestion free. You cannot conclude like this now, because your shorter RTT might be because of the nearest router that served you. So you cannot conclude that the network is congestion free and pump more packets into the network. So that's again a very interesting area in my opinion, because after several years, we are again getting a chance to relook into TCP in a completely different kind of a network, because TCP has time and again modified itself, was not suitable for wireless network. They made it suitable for wireless network. Was not suitable for data center network. They made it suitable for data center network by adding lot more things on top of it. Now there's a big question whether TCP should be used or not. In NDN sim, TCP is used. AIMD behavior of TCP is used. That's how they are currently sending the traffic. So we have done some work and said we have a better way of helping your TCP, which is not so smart here, to get little bit of intelligence so that it can take a concrete call and avoid the congestion. I'll come to that. That's the next slide, EBMD after. So, what are the issues? As I said, you know, entire timeout mechanism of TCP is also based on RTT. How is timeout calculated? I keep observing the RTT for a period of time and then have a moving average, which tells me what should be the RTO. Now that moving average will be incorrect because my RTT sometimes will be very small, sometimes it will be very large. And in the RTO calculation of TCP, there is a specific variable called min RTT. What is min RTT? The minimum RTT that you have ever observed. And what will happen now? Because this router replied to me immediately, this will always be stored as my min RTT, whereas actually the fact was that since it was cache, it was a min RTT. If it was not cache, what is my min RTT? Very complicated calculations, and timeout will be now inaccurate. So we can't depend on these two things, and that's why. So whatever you call here, interest rate shaping is exactly what TCP does. Increase the rate, reduce the rate. That mechanism is called interest rate shaping. You can read it like request sending rate. That is another way to look at this particular word. So how frequently I send requests, I can control by using this particular mechanism. Okay, controlling the sending rate of the interest packets. Now there are three categories of such algorithm. One is called consumer driven. So you let consumer decide how many interest per second should I send. If I send too many interest per second, then I am generating a lot more data into the network. So it can send less number of requests so that the network will be less congested. You know, this is something very similar to CoAP, the constraint application protocol used in IoT. The biggest problem there is it is used on top of UDP. UDP doesn't give reliability, UDP doesn't give congestion control. So people have been trying to put congestion control in CoAP, which is called COCOA, congestion based CoAP. Now what does it do? It doesn't have a sliding window like TCP. It looks at the RTT and the RTO and decides how many request packets the CoAP client should send to the CoAP server. So it reduces the number of requests to reduce the network congestion. And second one is hop by hop. This is taken care by the end device. This is taken care by the NDN routers. So if they see that the network is getting congested, they pass on the information to their previous router to reduce the sending rate. So because I am the sixth router, I am getting congested. By the time this information gets to the consumer, I will probably start dropping the packet. So what do I do? Old strategy mentioned in Tenenbaum textbook, hop by hop choke packets. What do? I take a packet, I tell my previous router, slow down. My previous router will tell its previous router. It will tell its previous router, ultimately this is called a back pressure technique. So you are applying the pressure on the backward side so that the congestion on you reduces immediately. So there are lots of work, there is a lot of work done in this and a combination of both. So there are lots of papers, in fact there is one survey paper that summarizes all of this and all of this. So very nice amount of work has gone into it. Now what did we do? We came up with a small algorithm called back pressure based congestion avoidance model. It's a framework and it works on the logic of the queue management. So we measure the queue at the router and then we decide whether I should apply the back pressure or I should not apply the back pressure. So typically what was happening in NDN is only when the router becomes full, the queue becomes full, then it starts applying back pressure. What we do here is we use a very old queue management algorithm which is proactive in nature, doesn't wait for your queue to become full. Before the queue becomes full, you start informing your previous hop that please reduce the rate of congestion. This is not something new, it's just that we have taken a very old algorithm into a new framework and we are trying to see whether it offers any benefits. What is the goal? We want to minimize the packet drops and enhance the link utilization. So we want link utilization to be 100%, packet drop to be as minimum as possible. And the proof of concept we gave by using adaptive random early detection, 2001 paper, it never went on to become a draft or a RFC. This is called control delay. This is again an algorithm by Van Jacobson. RFC 8289 is this algorithm. And PIE by Cisco. Cisco proposed this particular queue management for their devices. That is in RFC 8033. So what we did is we used these three algorithms inside Beacon and compared with the original behavior of NDN. And we use the NDN sim, and as I said, we are measuring these two things. This was the work that we had done at that time. So I explained to you already the three main components. We do queue monitoring using any one of those three algorithms that I said. And as soon as I know that the router is getting congested, I apply the interest limiting using back pressure. So I tell my previous hop that I'm getting congested, please reduce. But we also do one more thing. We use a NAC also. NAC is end-to-end. End-to-end meaning, I send a NAC, it directly goes to the consumer. Based on NAC, nobody takes any action. But inside this NAC packet, we added one bit. And what we said, when the NAC is going back to the consumer, looking at this bit, my previous router will know that I need to reduce my congestion. So we apply both the things. We inform the source explicitly, as well as we inform hop by hop people so that they can immediately give me relaxation in terms of reducing the congestion. So this is a diagrammatic picture, and we presented this work at IISc in the 10th edition of IEEE ANTS. We had got good feedback from the reviewers. In fact, we were successful in getting an honorable best paper award for this work, mainly because of the reason that we showed the proof of concept and presented some results. Because 2-3 years down the line, NDN SIM usage was very little. And the reason we were able to work on NDN SIM is because it's completely on top of NS3. So we were able to immediately understand. And in my opinion, anyone who has an idea of NS3, you will find it super easy to work with NDN SIM. So we used two topologies. We created congestion in one link, and we created multiple bottlenecks also. Because most important research in congestion control today is not just to show congestion on one path, but to show congestion on multiple bottlenecks. So we have either the consumer going through this or this. In NDN, if there are two paths, you can apply load balancing and utilize both the links. So I'll show you the results of each of this. This is with single bottleneck topology. This is the traditional NDN algorithm. This is with beacon one algorithm, beacon with another algorithm, beacon with third algorithm. And what we show is, we show the average link utilization in Mbps. So 10 is the maximum that you will get because we have configured 10 here. So you cannot have more than 10. And this is within percentage. So we can see the link utilization here, and we can see the packet drop rate here. That's because back pressure applies only when your queue becomes full. And when your queue becomes full, whatever packets are coming has to be dropped until the sender now knows that you have applied back pressure. In the second one, we can see we are able to saturate the link completely with a much lesser packet drop rate. The only reason this is happening is because we are proactive in detecting congestion, not allowing the entire queue to become full, responding much in advance. And how are we responding? Based on either this algorithm or this algorithm or this algorithm. And why one of them each performs like this is a completely different story. I can talk about that separately. But we were able to conclude that the latest algorithm of Cisco, that is 8033, without dropping packets, it was able to give us 100% link utilization. And this we verified in a multiple bottleneck topology once again, where you see these two are link utilization of two links, link 1 and link 2, these two. And the last one is packet drop rate. So again, here we can see it's not able to saturate 10 Mbps, none of these links. Packet drop rate is fine, no problem. Here your packet drop rate goes further down, and link utilization here we can see the best. It completes 10 Mbps, as well as the second link is almost 10 Mbps utilized. Now, we found that these results are promising. So our next course related to this work is that this was a simple file request simulator. Means there is one consumer, there are three consumers asking for a file from one producer, and here there is only one consumer asking a file from one producer. But we have not added the bursty traffic. Bursty traffic means different size data is requested. Right now the data requested was of the same size. This is an assumption made in the simulation. Now we would like to have different packet sizes. We'll have to have a burst created, means 15-20 consumers blasting at the same time requesting for the data, and one or two consumers are long lasting, they are downloading a big file. How will this bursty traffic impact the queue occupancy? Because when a burst of request comes, your queue tends to become fuller faster. So that is not yet done. We intend to do that testing. We also want to check, can we apply the same algorithm without using NAC, because we have a fear that NAC will be removed from NDN. So if that is the case, then our strategy should not have any issues. And finally, we are trying to set up a small testbed using NDN forwarding daemon. I will talk about that in a moment. To evaluate the working of the gun, basically take 3 or 4 machines, develop a testbed, put NDN on that so that it doesn't use the TCP/IP stack. It uses the NFB stack, and then ask for the data from the producer and let the consumer download, and we will do queue management and see how beacon works. So we are in the process of setting it up, but setting up NFB was a big challenge for us. I will tell you what we did. Okay, second work was presented at ANTS 2017, the subsequent year, and it was on privacy. Now this is something that we have still not developed a complete model, but I would just like to talk about it because it's an open area of research and anybody can come and do work on it. The name of this is Group Caching for Privacy in NT. So it's, now for example, Sir is my NTN router. I am in the direct link of that particular router. What I can do is, as an attacker, I can send a series of different content names to him and look at the response time. And if I see that the response time is really low, I can make a prediction of what is the content stored inside this particular content store. So I am able to infer what you have stored. Means the privacy of the data is lost. I can actually replicate what exactly your content store is having. So this was a paper came out by the same NDN team, and they said there is a privacy issue. So we proposed a distributed content store. What we proposed is, instead of me sending a request to one router, actually there are these four people who have formed a group and their content store is distributed. So if anybody, so for example, if I forward the request to Sir, if he doesn't have it from his content store, he will reply from that content store. And instead of looking at the individual content store, I will look at the distributed content store, which is formed by a group of these n number of routers. Now, there's a big problem open. How many numbers of router are optimal to form a group? Whether they should be geographically nearby? Don't you want to maximize the cache hit? Yes, these are all the open issues that we are still handling. And we got the paper based on the analytical proof by saying that we can handle the privacy issues if you have a group of routers rather than an individual router, because it makes attackers' life difficult to be able to predict the content came from Sir's router or Sir's router or Sir's router. All that the router, all that the person knows is it came from this group, but which particular person responded from that group is not easy to identify. That's what just we proved. We didn't do have, we don't have any implementation of this at the moment, but we are slowly progressing in that particular direction, and this is what I was just telling you. So there is a group of these NDN routers which are actually having these end users, and you can take caching decisions which will be done by a manager. So there will be these four people, and we can switch from one to another and as a manager role. And we proved that manager will be basically taking care of how to respond to the requests that are coming without having any performance demerit, because you don't want to provide more privacy by compromising the performance. The challenge is performance should be retained and still little bit of privacy should be improved. So this is under implementation. There is no concrete implementation of this yet, it's just a concept. Okay, coming towards the last part, I hope I'm not delaying another 5 minutes, 6 minutes. I have 1.5 hour presentation. So this is NDM SIM. This is completely based on NS3. There's a very nice documentation available for it. Please feel free to go through it. I have given the link from where you can access the particular website. I'll be sharing the PPT, so don't try to write it down. No need for that. Go to this particular place, simulation examples. Line by line explanation of at least 20 programs is given, starting from one producer, one NDN router, one consumer. Then you can make a grid and make the leftmost part of the grid as the consumer and the rightmost part as the producer. What is the advantage you get? Now you will understand how FIB gets created, because when there was a consumer followed by a router followed by a producer, there is only one path. But now when you have a grid, there are different paths through which you can go to the producer. So you can actually apply different routing algorithms like NLSR, OSPFN, and see in that simulation how does FIB get created. That will give a very good picture. And nearly about 20 examples they have explained line by line, which is like a phenomenal effort put up by the team, and we should appreciate that that easy to learn material is being provided by them. So this is that. And we found two, three years back, one of my students came and said, "Sir, installing NDN SIM itself is a nightmare. I am struggling since 1 month, I am not able to install." The reason, because there is no tarball available. You can't download as a tarball, unzip and install, like typically we do for a software. They expect you to go to different GitHub repositories and pull different directories and then put together and then combine. And not only that, the biggest problem is that packages version keeps changing. And they have a requirement that you should have a package more than that. So one thing that we did, and it was well appreciated by Professor Lishia Zhang, who is the principal investigator of NDN project, is that we made a small shell script, and nothing else was done. Believe me, we just went to the website, looked at their commands and put them in a shell script, resolving problems wherever was. But the only thing is, we said one step installation of NDN. That means you just put a shell on your desktop, run that shell, it downloads all the packages, builds NDMCM, handles all the package dependencies, runs the test program, and tells you whether NDMCM is properly installed or not. So that is also available in bottom link. This is a snapshot. There's something called contributed code from the community, and there they have listed our work, saying that we recommend you to use this script because it will, for beginners who are not familiar with pulling the repositories from GitHub, it becomes very difficult for them to even try on one basic example. Once you are good at GitHub and pulling this repositories and version control system, if you have played with it, then it is very easy done installation for you. But for those who are getting started, we wanted to simplify it. So that one work was done. Then this is the website for forwarding daemon. You can get the overview. Again, same examples have been given, and then man pages have been given, because the moment you get it in your operating system, you use these man pages to understand basically what commands are useful for what purposes. So they have done, there's a wiki. I recommend you to go to this particular wiki and see the installation steps and everything. This is the URL for that particular NFT. Coming to ChronoChat, this is something that we deployed at MITK as a small BTEC project. Two girls with their two laptops, they installed NFT. They have an API called ChronoSync. Using ChronoSync, they have developed ChronoChat. I mean, they means not my students, they means the NDN developers. And there is one team in NDN community that focuses only on the applications of NDN. There is another team in NDN community that focuses only on the networking of NDN. So they have bifurcated two different teams at all. One person who I know very closely working with applications of NDN is Jeff. And he is also from UCLA. I had the opportunity to meet him. He was in Bangalore for spreading word about something else, not about NDN. But I'll tell you how I came to know. There is an open consortium of NDN, and the most beautiful part is it's completely free to join the consortium. So 2 years back, I made NITK Suratkal as a member of the NDN consortium so that we have an access to their all the details that they are having in the mailing list, which is actually closed. Outside, it's not shown. So all the discussions like, where is the next NDN conference? So NDN conference is there. There's NDN hackathon. They conduct hackathon, call people, students, program, they develop NDN applications. And recently, this year for the first time, NIM Data Networking has been selected as a GSOC organization. Means they want you to develop apps which can be used on phones without using TCP/IP stack, but you can use NDN stack. So if you have some students who are interested to apply for GSOC, they should look at NDN organization. There's a very good opportunity to develop some NDN applications. So one of the applications that we deployed ChronoChat, and Jeff was motivating me, telling me that why don't you deploy it entire NITK-wide? It was really difficult, administrative reasons, other reasons, but we did it on two node machines. So we had two laptops, and using ChronoChat, we demonstrated that one can talk to each other like a normal instant messaging. And if you want, I have a configuration file, 3-page PDF, in which my students have written steps to reproduce their work, so that if anybody wants to reproduce their work, it should be easy for you to do it in the same way. And this is a GitHub repository. It's pretty frequently updated. Like last commit was 20 days ago, which is fairly decent update. So this is ChronoChat. This is my next goal. My goal is to have a real-time NDN node to be deployed at MITK. You can see this is the current testbed. So sir, this is a live NDN testbed. And on their namedata.net website, they have kept videos which they have used. I mean, they have accessed the videos from UCLA to Beijing, China, using complete NDN. No IP base there. So they have demonstrated the video quality and compared with the IP and NDN. And of course, we can say that IP is overloaded right now, so performance will be a little poor there. But what they want to show is that NDN is working. It means that it's already live and you can connect to it. Now you can see here, the only thing is, we are here and there is no NDN node in India. What is the advantage do you have of an NDN node? If we can have an NDN node, the traffic will pass through this NDN node and we will be able to understand the proper behavior of an NDN. Understand how routing works, understand how forwarding works, how name prefix will work, because we'll have access to that data. So I briefly spoke about the investment that we will need with Professor Vishya when I was in UCLA last October. I had taken an appointment, she was very kind enough to give 1 hour of discussion. And I learned that it is not a very heavy investment. We can have an NDN node, the only investment will be in maintaining it, which is also not very heavy. So I'm looking forward to prepare a proposal if possible, and then maybe see if some funding organizations would allow me to have an NDN node, because it's the first time in India that will happen. and we will have manpower getting ready to basically learn how NDN works, how NDN can be configured, and start discussing and adding. So by the way, at NITK, I have added a course already in our curriculum for ICN, not NDN. I have added a course for ICN where I'm teaching MTech students some small bits and chunks about NDN. So I believe that having that will actually be advantageous because students will get live practice of looking at this particular NDN. So hope that I'll be able to do something on that. These are some of the common questions that people have. What are the best use cases of NDN? Vehicular networking. When you are in a vehicle moving and you are interacting with your roadside infrastructure, it will be great if your roadside infrastructure can give you the chunk from there itself. Because you are in a high speed car or a train, and the entire world, including India, is moving to a digital economy. Everywhere we want people to be connected. Right now what we do is we have a router that's sitting on top of the train and providing Wi-Fi. If that router itself has data cache like an NDN router, then the performance of the people using the internet connectivity over there will improve. So there are some dedicated use cases in vehicular networking. There is an NDN based IoT. Again, because in IoT it's more about PubSub. It's about publishing and subscribing and circulating as much as data as possible to the sync node or to the next node. So IoT is very, and there are some recent papers that people have put up. So I'll tell you where to find the papers also. And the secure routing, basically. And this is also very important. As I said, NLSR, OSPFN, all are moving towards secure routing. Is there an active consortium for NDN? Yes, this is a website. You can go, you can register your organization. They are more than happy to have. So I'm not sure of the industry and organization whether there is any money. But for non-profit and academia, it's free. And that's why I did the paperwork, convinced my administration, and we became the member of the NDN. So we now keep getting frequent newsletters, whatever discussions happen, and we try to circulate to our students as well as we put up on the other places. So please visit this. And is NDN active as of now? As I said, yes, it's already active currently. So I think that was it, but I'll show you where the publications can be found. In the first slide I said namedata.net, just go there, there's a tab called publications, and you'll get, there's a tab called publication, there's a tab called code base. You'll get code of everything, simulator, NFD, ChronoChat, ChronoSync. If you go to publication, proper year-wise segregation of 2019 down to other years. So, but I think that is pretty much of what I had to discuss. Hope I was able to do justice with your time. Thank you for giving me an opportunity. I will be also happy to answer offline if, in case we are going for lunch now, we can have a discussion during lunch.
One, two, three questions.
Sir, please, definitely.
How are the security and privacy issue handled? You are creating one list of the interest. If the contents are cached there in the router,
yes.
Secondly, some contents belong to some private data or some user.
Again, so sir, if there is a data which is too private and which is supposed to be secure, NDN is not a good network for you. If you really want your content to be very securely exchanged between the TLS, then you tend to use the normal internet for that purpose. But what we are talking about is the video content which is openly available. It is not definitely so much private that you may want to encrypt it, or you may want, I mean, of course basic encryptions will be required, but it's not something that you really worry about being kept inside that particular.
Not about, sir. Even that data is not encrypted, but still it shows my interest. Like, I have seen that particular video and I wanted that
particular. Yeah, so router can keep track of your interest. What kind of request are you sending?
But still it's a privacy issue.
We can term it as a privacy issue, but you know what our browsers do anyway. They any all website use cookies.
Yeah.
They already know what our browsing pattern is. They already know what I am interested in. The moment I have taken an electronic gadget in Amazon, next day I go, it recommends me similar gadgets. So, I mean, I'm not saying that you should definitely compromise with those aspects, but then if you want performance, there will be some trade-off. Security doesn't come easily. We have to pay a penalty in terms of performance. If you want performance, little bit of relaxation towards.
Can I rephrase this in a different way?
Sure, sir.
Now the data is in an NDN router.
Yes.
Would NDN router also be tracking which user is asking for
it? I understood that better.
Or
so
can we just say that it knows that within this area there is a demand for it,
yeah,
but I can't pinpoint which user asked for it?
Yeah, so I mean, asking to be honest, routers shouldn't be doing this. Routers shouldn't be keeping track and forming a behavior pattern of my request. But if you have a person, network admin, who has actually implemented this thing to be done in the router, it's so easy to do. Because everything is there with you. So at least the content name will be open, if not the data. Data will be encrypted, but the content name will be open. I will find out from the content name what are you trying to access. So if it all depends on how we go about implementing it.
But even in DNS and all, we have tried to add security for the same reasons, right?
Yeah.
So I thought like here it could be not an afterthought but something.
No, that's not the case.
Taking care from the day one.
No, it's not the case. It's still not the case. Maybe down the line in future, they may try to add it. Right now we have signatures only for the producers. Tomorrow we don't know what they will try to prevent this kind of breach. But as of now, what I have understood from the NDN architecture, I don't think it's difficult for the router to form a behavior pattern of what you are trying to access. It can, essentially.
Sir, this NDN is being supported by current internet infrastructure, right?
Only that test bed.
Only that test
bed is live. I don't see any major application service providers using NDN test bed. Right now, it's only for experimental purposes.
Extra hardware like router and all, it supports actually.
Yes, you will need to have different kinds of architecture of the router to support CS, to support PIT, to support FIB.
It is not on top of the existing
infrastructure. We can, as I said, we can put on top of the existing infrastructure, but then it's better you use IP itself rather than using both of them at top.
So this is totally, this experimental?
It's a separate aspect, and there are some video files and data files that they have for experimental purposes hosted on either the paging server or the UCLA server. And if you get an access to this testbed, you might as well run live experiments using NDN, not touching IPv6.
One more question,
sir. Please.
Is it not the overlap of responsibility? Because routers are generally deals with packets or something.
Yeah.
It is doing something which is done by applications.
I agree. And that's a strong argument by the authors of NDN. They say you delegate this work to the network, then you will have more scalability. So you are passing on the ball of all this onto the router head, which actually routers earlier were not supposed to do all of this, right? They are simply finding out the route and sending our packets. Now they are going to store the data. They'll have all more things to do. So router complexity will increase, but what they are telling, in future you want the end user device complexity to reduce. So somewhere the complexity will go, right? Either it will go to the server or either it will go somewhere. So they are trying to push it to the network. So
one more question, is it necessary that all the packets related to the one request will be read by that router?
Is it possible? That means you are asking that if there are 10 chunks of that video, the entire video is cached?
Yeah.
Well, if it's a very popular video, there is a possibility that all 10 chunks will be cached. But we are assuming a very optimal case where people are not asking for any other data at all. Everybody is asking for just that video. Then you will have all the chunks identified in. So I will leave the room with one suggestion that if we go through once again, possibly Dr. Balaji's and Sanjay's session is going to help us, if we can thoroughly go through the DNS functionality and how BitTorrent works, you will get a crisp idea of why NDN is a reality. It looks theoretically it is very difficult, but it's already a reality with the testbed and it's growing. The testbed is growing. If we can understand, so BitTorrent has the same thing, sir. I just ask for a content from a peer. What's the guarantee that the peer has entire movie? It's not guaranteed, right? We use a DHT to find out which chunk will be there and which peer. Same things are here. Slightly in a different way, completely removing the IP base, adding the content. But thank you very much for the patience.